my name is Hero Job Shibe, and this is Musings of a Shy Podcast, a Dogecoin peer-to-peer sharing economy show. And you are listening to...
This is episode 18, Kavade Impotor, Let the Buyer Beware.
This episode is going to be the first episode of a trilogy. I have decided to break down the Ross Ulbricht case, the United States versus Ross Ulbricht, or otherwise known as the Silk Road case, or you may refer to as the Dred Pyatt Roberts case, into three parts. The first part is I'm going to cover the basic elements of the case itself, what the United States government is charging Ross Ulbricht, why he's being charged, the different terms that are being bantered and talked about in the news that are associated with the case. The second part of this episode is going to be dealing with the Silk Road in itself, and I will cover the timeline of its existence as well as the timeline of both the Bitcoin itself and the Bitcoin price. And there will also be a little bit about Mt. Gox, because Mt. Gox has been brought up in association with the case. And the third episode and the last part of this trilogy is going to deal with the implications of the trial in itself, the charges that are being charged against Ross Ulbricht, the type of charges that has been leveled at him, the legal precedent that will be set if he is convicted, and most importantly, what it would have, the chilling effect that it may have on the internet in and of itself if he is convicted. But before we get into the episode in itself, I'm going to do a little bit of news and then a scam alert. So here's the news. This news story comes out of CoinDesk, written by John Southworth. Basically, what this story is about is that 5,000 Taiwan convenience stores have opened themselves up to being allowing Bitcoin to pay for goods and services. It is through their local exchange called BitoEX, and I have a link into the article, a link in the article in the show notes. But basically, they break down how they were able to do this feat in bringing these convenience stores into the fold, into the Bitcoin market. So it's a great article to look up. Another thing is that Pirate Bay, a site has gone up, and it's piratebay.se, and it's basically has a little tag that says we are TBB, which is we are the Pirate Bay, and it has a countdown clock on to when it is possibly going to reopen up. There's a little pirate flag that's flagging around on the website, but a countdown has been issued into when Pirate Bay is going to come back into the world again. Another thing is that the Bitcoin prices have plummeted and risen again. Currently, at the time of the recording of the show, one Bitcoin is $215.84. I have a link in the show notes about a wonderful little article about phases of bubble corrections and about investment, and is a pretty much something that was designed for the overall market in itself, but it's something that you can apply to any kind of market phase on the different phases that various markets go through. It's a wonderful little map and a breakdown in very simple terms about how the market works and about bubbles. Another thing is that in Reddit, in the crypto markets, Redditor Econ Doge wrote up a very wonderful article about the Dogecoin community, about the economics of the Dogecoin community, and how the different numbers break down from Doge to BTC, Doge to USD, our worth, our value, our volume, our highs and lows, and just a breakdown overall of basically mathematical accounting numbers about Dogecoin, and how this individual feels that there's a bit of optimism to look for 2015. So I'm just going to quote a little bit from the post. It's for 2015. Looking forward, I'm somehow optimistic. The initial supply has been mostly exhausted. So without added pressure of miners selling, this could mean higher prices if adoption picks up. Exchanges added Dogecoin or Bitcoin prices recover. Internally, I believe developers will keep the network and client up to date and running, although there seems to be little interest into innovate. So we will have to see if just being a tipping cryptocurrency with a great community is enough to keep Dogecoin relevant. As for the price, there are a lot of unknowns, and as I mentioned now that most of the coins have in mind, we could see some more volatility in busy days followed by sideways trading like it is happening right now. Targets make little sense. So for now, I think our floor is the 20s. He's referring to the price in 20 Satoshis. The upside will depend on how much discount or on valuation is given to both Bitcoin and Litecoin. So far, we're around 2,000% discount versus Litecoin alone. So it's just a little nice little numbers thing. If you're into numbers about Dogecoin, I will have a link in the show notes about it. As a little bit of a follow-up, buying Redico with any digital currency without leaving Reddit is now possible, which is made by possible by Redditor HillDB. He is a Doge bot that was created called Coin Gold Bot, and basically you'll be able to purchase Reddit Gold with any cryptocurrency right now. Right now there is Reddit Gold with Dogecoin, which was created by user Mulan, who is the creator of the Doge Tip Bot on Reddit and Twitch. But as of now, there is now another tip bot out there that accepts any cryptocurrency for the purchase of Reddit Gold. And in the news and the subject of our episode, the trial for Ross Ulrich, the United States versus Ross Ulrich, began this week on Tuesday, January 13th, in the state of New York at the federal court in New York City. There will be more on that. But before we get into the episode itself, we have a bit of a cryptocurrency scam alert. As of right now, CryptoDouble was a site that had promised that within 100 hours, your investment of Bitcoin would be doubled, hence the title of the website. All related websites, Facebook and Twitter pages, seem to be deactivated at the moment in time. But the latest scam, this particular scam in itself, has absconded with at least 2,200 BTC, or about $500,000 of BTC has been cashed out on the exchange BTCe, basically leaving thousands of customers out of pocket. It's a scam, again, that promised to double people's money, which is something that people need to be cautious of, because it was something that was guaranteed in a short amount of time with very little or no explanation. But as of now, this is something that has occurred. It's being reported on. There's efforts to launch a class action suit. No doubt that the SEC and any government bodies have been informed, or complaints have been made. And so this is going to be another ongoing scam scandal within the cryptocurrency. But if you're somebody that has had some funds on CryptoDouble, you're not getting that back. They're gone. But I have a link in the show notes, and it's just you should click on the article and read about it, just so you can have some self-awareness about the different types of scams that are out there, and to do a bit of more research and making sure that the individuals that you're doing business with are legitimate, that everything is the up and up. It's okay to ask questions. It's okay to email people, to check up on business licenses if such business license exists, to ask around, to post questions in either our Bitcoin or Bitcoin Talk, and talk to people, or go through as many different Bitcoin or cryptocurrency related pages that are out there, websites, and just ask questions and ask people, you know, what is this particular site all about? How is this happening? And you're going to find answers very quickly on whether or not this is something you should be doing. So again, just a little bit of a scam alert. CryptoDouble is a Bitcoin scam that has absconded with at least 2233 BTCs, about $500,000 worth of money, and it's cashed out, and that money is gone, basically, and has left a lot of customers in a lurch. They've absconded with the funds. There's talk about putting a class action lawsuit against the company and tracking down the owners. And no doubt, as this story develops, there will be some form of a regulatory or criminal proceedings against these individuals. Okay, so that is it for the news. Now on to the episode at hand. So on this first part of the episode of this trilogy, I'm just going to lay out the basic elements of the case and break it down into 6 points or 6 terms that you should be aware of. You should be aware of what is being discussed in the case, and who Ross Ulrich is, and what Silk Road is, and Tor and Deep Web, and what is going on. So you can follow along on this case, because this case is very important. It's not just necessarily just about drugs or Bitcoin or any of that. It does have have some ramifications on the internet as a whole and as individuals within the United States. So first off, basic facts. The United States government is versus Ross William Ulbricht. The judge is Catherine Foster. It's taking place at the federal courthouse in New York City, New York. The prosecutor, I could not find any information on the lead prosecutor, but the defense lawyer is Joshua Dertrell. The counts against Ross Ulbricht are trafficking drugs on the internet, narcotics trafficking conspiracy, computer hacking conspiracy, money laundering conspiracy, and then 6 uncharged crimes of murder for hire. This is what he has. He has these crimes that these uncharged crimes are something that even though the prosecution has not had the evidence or the ability to indict him on these uncharged crimes, they still can bring it up in the court. So he has 6 uncharged crimes of murder for hire. And so those are the basic elements of the case. Ross Ulbricht has pled not guilty. The trial started January 13th of this year. It is expected to go on for 6 weeks. So these are the 7 points I want to bring up about this case and trying to break down what is going on or the elements that are being discussed in the case so you can be properly informed. The first point is, what is Silk Road? Silk Road, and this is something that Ross Ulbricht has admitted to doing, was a marketplace, it was an online black marketplace, best known for, selling illegal drugs. It is part of what is called the Tor Hidden Services, and I'll explain what Tor is. And basically what it was a marketplace set up in a similar fashion that a Craigslist or any eBay or any of those type of online services that sell goods and services online, for the purpose of selling goods and services with the ability to purchase these goods and services with Bitcoin. So if you were to access Silk Road through the Tor network and you wanted to purchase something on Silk Road, you would have to use Bitcoin to make a purchase. If you wanted to sell something on Silk Road, you would have to sell your goods and services for Bitcoin. And basically, it was a platform that was primarily used to sell narcotics. That was 70% of the selling base or the products that were being sold on the marketplace. It was established in February 2011, and eventually it was shut down by the FBI in October of 2013. So that is basically what Silk Road is. There has been other websites that have developed based on the concept of using Tor as a means to sell drugs on the marketplace or create a online service that sells goods and services on the marketplace with Bitcoin as one of the primary means of purchasing these items. And there's also been other Silk Roads that have been created. After the initial shutdown by the FBI and the seizing of servers that Silk Road operated on, it was relaunched again in November of 2013. It was called Silk Road 2.0. That has also been shut down. It was shut down last year in November of 2014. And there has been other dark web or dark net sites that have developed since the creation of Silk Road, since the collapse of Silk Road 2.0, that has entered in the marketplace to do basically the same thing that Silk Road has done, which was selling primary drugs, but all types of goods and services that could have been bought on the site with the purchase of Bitcoin. So that is Silk Road. Now, I'm going to explain a little bit about what deep web is, because it's something that is brought up a lot in association with Silk Road and Tor. Basically, what the deep web is the ability for websites, forums, anything that is on the internet to not be easily searched. So basically, when you have a website name, for example, www.ebay.com. In order to access a website, for example, if eBay was on the deep web, you would actually have to know the exact address. You would have to know that it was www.ebay.com in order to access it. You couldn't search it through your regular browsers like an Internet Explorer, Firefox, Chrome. Any web browser out there would not easily readily pick it up. A lot of times these type of web search sites, browser sites, deliberately don't allow access to Tor sites. And I'll get into what Tor is, or these deep websites, because of illegality, but other times because of the manner upon which the individuals set up the website so they would not, you can directly access it. And that's pretty much what deep web is. It's not primarily used for illegal purposes, even though it has been used for illegal purposes. A lot of times the reason why people use Tor or these type of deep web services is so that they can protect their information. A lot of times like reporters or activists live in countries where if they speak out against their government or companies or certain individuals, they're subject to being put in prison, being killed, being sought after, having their lives being threatened. So you have a lot of private individuals that utilize the tools associated with the dark web. And I will the biggest thing is Tor, and they utilize that type of service to protect their identity. Now, there are other types of services out there that operate on the deep web, but we're just going to talk about primarily Tor because that's what Silk Road used. So what is Tor? Tor is something that, first off, the United States government developed. So before you hear this on the news a lot about Tor being associated with dark web and illegal activities, everything from drugs to child porn to terrorism, you have to understand something, that the Tor was developed by the United States government, particularly by the U.S. Navy. And the reason why they developed Tor is for the sole purpose of protecting information, particularly intelligence communications. So Tor was developed, again, it was developed by the U.S. Navy. It came out of DARPA. DARPA is a big think tank of the United States government. A lot of significant ideas, concepts, hardware, a lot of the particular electronics equipments and ideas that you currently use in the world right now, a lot of it has come out of DARPA in some shape or form. And basically what it did was, it was just a means of keeping communication safe on the internet. That was the primary reason. And Tor in itself is an acronym called the Onion Routing Project. It was launched in September of 2002 and has been open to the public pretty much from the get-go. The U.S. Navy still, in 2004, it released the code for Tor under free license. Electronic Frontier Freedom began funding Tor in itself because Tor is a nonprofit organization as well as a program, and it's used by the U.S. Navy, again, is used by journalism, is used by a lot of people. It's not just for illegal activity. And I'm going to break down who uses Tor, because I think it's very important when people discuss Tor and what it is and the concept of Tor. They have to understand it's just a tool. And like any tool, it can be used for purposes of good or the purposes of bad, depending on who's using it. And I don't necessarily mean bad as in evil, but it could be like, if you're hammering a nail to a piece of wood, you can do it either well or you can do it, god awful. Again, it is not the fault of the nail or the hammer or even the piece of wood. It's all about the human who operates these different types of tools. Also, it's important to know that Tor, the nonprofit organization responsible for the Tor code and the Tor project, they received a lot of grants from the United States government still, even including private funding. And 60% of its funding comes from the State Department and the Department of Defense. So before, when you get in these discussions and people talk about how it's an evil thing or it's, used for illegality, it's funded by the United States government. So it can't be something that's completely awful or bad. If it's being used by the U.S. government, it's not being shut down completely, even though there has been crackdowns on the Tor in itself through criminal proceedings. But that's the end of the rant there. So who uses Tor? I'm going to read this straight from the Guardian article, which was written by Stuart Dredge, and it came out November of 2013. The Tor project team says that users fall into four main groups. Normal people who want to keep their internet activities private from websites and advertisers. Those concerned about cyber spying, and users invading censorship in certain parts of the world. So again, journalists and activists, my little interjection in here, they don't want anyone to know what they're doing on the internet. They want to be able to freely discuss and communicate from person to person without fear of reprisal. The United States military still uses Tor as a means of communication. So continuing from the article, Tor notes that the technology is used by military professionals. The U.S. Navy is still a key user, as well as activists, journalists, and countries with strict censorship of media and the internet. Campaigning body Reporters Without Borders advises journalists to use Tor, for example. Tor also cites bloggers, business executives, IT professionals, and law enforcement officers as key users, with the latter including police needing to mask their IP addresses when working undercover online or investigating questionable websites and services. For more mainstream users, it can mean running Tor so that their children's location can't be identified when they're online, or it can mean a political activist in China, Russia, or Syria can protect their identity. And after the NSA surveillance revelations in 2013, a new wave of users joined the service. Between August of 19 and August of 27 alone, the number of people using Tor more than doubled to 2.25 million. According to Tor's own figures, before peaking at nearly 6 million in mid-September, it slipped back to just over 4 million. So while Tor is out there on the interweb, it is not something that's so widely used. I mean, 4 million people, I'm sure there's some knockoff Facebook app or Snapchat app, or even just a little gaming app that has more users than people who use Tor. Now, what exactly Tor is basically the purpose of Tor, why it was developed, is it was developed again out of the U.S. Navy, a U.S. government project to mass communications to prevent anybody from directly accessing the information through the internet. It masks IP addresses, it masks websites, it masks any information from easily being traced and tracked down. And how they do this is by creating a software program called Tor and using what is called relays. These Tor relays is what you access when you have the software program and you activate it and you're searching online. You go through these relays that are scattered throughout the world. And it's from these relays that you're able to mask your IP address, your website, if you choose to use Tor as a means of hosting your website, and prevent anyone from tracking your information. So basically that's what Silk Road was one of these websites that was hosted on the Tor network, where you could only access it through the Tor software, through the Tor browser, and knowing the Silk Road address, you would be able to, through the Tor software program, get on to the Tor network and access Silk Road. It was not something that was readily or easily found, and deliberately so, on the internet. So that is what Tor is. Another aspect that's being brought up in this case is drugs. Drugs were, according to all accounts, were 70% of the business on Silk Road. And they primarily were illegal drugs, but not exclusively so. And depending on your location in the world, that drug could be illegal or legal within that country. Silk Road was a global website. It had buyers and sellers around the world selling goods and services through Silk Road to anyone and everyone. But the reason why Ross Ulbricht is facing these charges is because Silk Road was primarily utilized as a marketplace for the purpose of selling drugs, primarily illegal drugs, to people around the world. And how they were able to pay for these drugs and services was the use of Bitcoin. You could only purchase and buy items on Silk Road with the use of Bitcoin. And Bitcoin, what it is the cryptocurrency that was developed by Satoshi Nakamoto. Bitcoin uses peer-to-peer technology to operate with no central authority or banks to manage the transactions. Bitcoin has a monetary value. It goes up and down depending on the markets. It's open source, so the public has easy access to it. No one entity or person controls a Bitcoin. And this was the means or the payment service upon which Silk Road chose to receive not only its commissions from sales on the site, but for its vendors and buyers to use Bitcoin as a means of payment. Now, Ross Ulbricht has openly admitted that he created Silk Road, the marketplace, that he developed it. But his contention and his defense is that he gave up control of Silk Road within 6 months of his creation, and that he is not the online pseudonym, the Dread Pirate Roberts, who managed Silk Road. He had given up that identity, and that he was not that individual. So let me explain to you who Ross Ulbricht is. He is, as he's openly admitted to doing in his defense, the creator of Silk Road. He is 30 years old. He's from Austin, Texas. He has a bachelor's degree in science in physics and a graduate degree in education from Pennsylvania State University. This is something that I'm reading from his LinkedIn page. He also, at one point in time, was the CEO of a nonprofit organization called Goodwagon Books. Goodwagon Books basically took reusable items found in homes and then redistributed them to various charities, to basically nonprofit charities like inner city youth programs, prison literacy program within the state of California. And he is, he's openly admitted to being the creator of Silk Road. He states that he is not the pseudonym Dread Pirate Roberts, the owner and manager of the online marketplace Silk Road, as the United States government is alleging that he is. And he's the man who's facing trial for the crimes that the government has placed charges on him. So that's basically Ross Ulbricht. There's not much known about Ross Ulbricht. I mean, I will have a link to his defense site, Free Ross, but he just seems to be a very young, very smart man that had an idea that of creating was the Silk Road Marketplace to utilize cryptocurrencies as a means of payment. And it just went from there. I'm just kind of just sticking to the facts here. Now, I've mentioned Red Pirate Roberts a few times. The pseudonym comes from the character of the Princess Bride, and Dread Pirate Roberts is the pseudonym that the United States government states that Ross William Ulbricht was. But basically, the Dread Pirate Roberts is the individual that managed the marketplace and was administrator of Silk Road. He had the primary control of the website in and of itself. He basically said yes or no to the vendors that come on, to any of the additional help that may have been received on Silk Road, the different individuals that may operate the support structure, the customer, whether it be the software support, the hardware support, the server support of Silk Road, to the chat support, customer service support, anything and everything necessary to keep a website going. Dread Pirate Roberts was responsible for, and there's a significant amount of chat logs from the internal Silk Road servers to public chat logs of an individual going by the name of Dread Pirate Roberts talking about Silk Road and speaking to individuals about Silk Road itself. And some of these chats even go as far as talking about these murder for hire charges or uncharges that Ross Ulbricht is facing. The United States government is alleging that Dread Pirate Roberts is Ross Ulbricht. Ross Ulbricht, in his defense, is alleging that it's not only him, but it's completely somebody else. And the final two points of the Ross Ulbricht case is the one charge I didn't mention in the beginning, which is the Kingpin statue. The Kingpin statue is a charge called the Continuing Criminal Enterprise. And basically what this charge is that the law is applied to any criminal organization with six or more members organized by a single leader. In this case, because the United States government is alleging that Ross Ulbricht is the Dread Pirate Roberts, the individual running Silk Road Marketplace, and that Silk Road was a criminal organization, it was a criminal enterprise, he is the kingpin, and therefore he can face, with just this charge alone, up to 30 years if convicted just on this charge. If he's convicted with the other charges, it's just, you know, it's additional add. All the other charges don't particularly matter. He's just going away basically for life. And this has to do with a simple concept or legal concept called transfer of intent. And transfer intent is used when a defendant intends to harm one victim, but they unintentionally harm a second victim. In this case, the defendant's intent transfers from one intended victim to the actual victim and being used to satisfy the mens rea element of the crime that the defendant is being charged with. The transfer intent doctrine is only used for completed crimes, is not used for attempted crimes. And mens rea means the criminal intent, the state of mind of of indicating culpability, which is required by the statute of element in crime. So the state of the mind of the crime. So basically, what makes these last two charges or points, the legal doctrine of justifying the type of charges being levied against Ross Ulbricht, the transfer intent, and the kingpin charges, which is getting a lot of people, particularly those who are big advocates of freedom on the internet, is that because Ross Ulbricht created this Silk Marketplace roadside, and he created this website for the purpose of selling goods, and it so happens that this marketplace did in fact sell illegal narcotics, even though he himself did not sell narcotics, did not direct individuals per se to sell drugs. He just ran the website. He had no hand in the actual drug activity. People are deeply concerned by this because it could send a legal, it will establish a legal precedent that basically you're responsible for your customers' actions. For example, on Craigslist, you can, if you look for it and know the right code words, you can find various prostitutes or ladies of the night, if you will, on Craigslist advertising their goods and services through that site. Now, Craigslist could be held culpable for individuals using their website to advertise that type of illegal activity. Even though the intent of Craigslist is to sell all types of goods and services, it just so happens that a customer of theirs utilized their services for illegal purposes. And this is what a lot of people are very up in arms about this case, because they're deeply concerned by the fact that Ross Ulbridge is being charged with these crimes because of the actions of others, the actions of his customers. And again, this can open up a whole liability issue. It can also open up the fact that a lot of different types of services would either shut down or become very restrictive. You would have to put up more information about yourself in order to utilize the service. For example, Craigslist might not no longer be free. You might have to pay through a credit card or debit card, produce a photo identity before you can advertise that you're having a yard sale for your home, for the sheer fact that Craigslist is afraid that even though you state that you're doing a yard sale at your home, it's not actually your home, it's somebody else's home, and what you're selling are stolen goods. You know, Craigslist is not going to willing to take that chance. And there's other ramifications that can go beyond just that. You know, eBay or Amazon, individuals can, these websites can be held for the fact that maybe bad products or false products could have been were sold on their website, and they could be held culpable. And there's also the fact that he's being held on the kingpin status. This seems to be a bit of an overcharge on the part of the United States government. Many individuals feel that this is extremely unfair, particularly the nature of Silk Road. Even though he has been charged, not been charged, but there has been talked of the fact that he may or may not have done these murder for hire deals, that there has not actually been any death or violence associated with Silk Road. In fact, there are studies indicating that through the use of Silk Road, violence in a number of different areas plummeted across the country, across the country, because individuals no longer were meeting person to person. They're basically going online, paying through the use of Bitcoin. Everything was anonymous. And then within a certain designated date or time, your goods, your drugs were delivered to you. And so it reduced the physical interaction. It reduced the element of I don't have to know you. You don't have to know me. There's no possible way you could testify me or any of that kind of aspect or the criminal element. Also, the sheer fact, because of drugs are typically, the purchase of drugs are typically a cash-based business. You're not going from one place to another carrying a large amount of cash in the fear of being robbed or anything like that or ripped off. So violence dropped and plummeted. And so there's a number of individuals that have a significant issue with the kingpin status and just the charges against Ross Ulbridge in general. But for the internet purposes and for the purposes of a lot of people that believe in freedom, they're very deeply concerned by the nature of this prosecution and the fact that he developed this website. It was utilized for the purposes of criminal activities and that he's being held accountable for it. And so there's a number of individuals and a lot of people that are watching in this case because they're deeply concerned of the legal precedent that could be set if Ross Ulbridge is convicted. Now, on the U.S. government side of things, why they feel justified in essence, what many people believe to be or perceive to be an overcharge, but why they feel justified in these charges is because what the Silk Road marketplace has demonstrated is something that whether you agree with the U.S. government's policies on drug enforcement or not, what they have feared is that the internet would come into the drug marketplace more so than it already has. As in the case of Silk Road marketplace is done, if an eBay style type of marketplace or the eBaying of the drug market were to occur, there will be no means for them to properly enforce the current drug laws. And the Silk Road marketplace had already in essence demonstrated that. And how they demonstrated that was through the use of Bitcoin as a primary means of payment for goods and services on Silk Road, but also the anonymity that Tor had offered for the Silk Road users and vendors and customers, basically. These two combinations allowed and made for the eBaying of the drug marketplace. This is why you see a number of different types of deep web, dark market drug sites that have since flourished since the demise of both Silk Road 1 and Silk Road 2. But basically, because up to this point, even though drug transactions did in some ways occur occur on the internet. Most of them was primarily communications, which law enforcement has been successful in intercepting, obtaining, you know, the various texts and emails or however an individual may communicate through the internet. You could not, even if you wanted to really purchase drugs off the internet, because credit cards and wire transfers are easily traceable. Okay. The government can just sit on a bank and get the warrants necessary and track the payments. What Bitcoin did was it provided the anonymity between the individual, the customer, and the buyer, where the government was unable to easily and readily track that payment. They just weren't able to do so because there's no bank for them to sit on. And even if they were to sit on and watch the public ledger or figure out what someone's Bitcoin address was, there's still the possibility of shifting and sorting through their addresses and basically preventing the government from finding completely the individuals behind different types of drug transactions. They would literally have to have the private key or the computer that the individual used to make these transactions in order for them to track it down. And that takes time and a lot of effort. As the Silk Road case has demonstrated, what it took was that they were able to embed an informant into the Silk Road infrastructure, and that's how they were able to obtain a lot of information. But on the outside, it's not something they would easily be readily to do, because again, with Bitcoin, there is no bank for them to sit on. They can't sit on a bank and seek subpoenas and monitor accounts. It's not possible for them to do so. And because Tor allows for anonymity and the increase of encrypted communications, what Silk Road has demonstrated is it is possible to eBay the drug market. And this is why the U.S. government is coming down so hard on Ross Ulbricht, just because they're trying to scare people and preventing them from creating marketplaces similar or unique or along the lines that Silk Road marketplace is. So this is where I'm going to end the episode for part one of this trilogy on the United States government versus the Ross William Ulbricht case, or the Silk Road case. The second part of this episode is I'm going to go over the timeline of Silk Road from its inception until its demise, because it ties a lot of what's happened to the Silk Road ties into the price of Bitcoin, the progress that Bitcoin had made in the years that Silk Road was operational, as well as into Gox and the various Bitcoin exchanges that existed at the time that Silk Road was operational. My podcast shout outs this week are Snake Oil Podcast, a comic book podcast. Thank you for the podcast advice. RL Noob, a gaming podcast, and Archaeologist Podcast, which is a great kind of historical podcast. Out of the Fridge Comics Podcast. Salty Language Podcast, which is a great comedic show. Brave the World, which is a YouTube blog that has been covering the Free Ross case for quite a while now. Dogecoin Dark Radio, which covers the coin Dogecoin Dark, as well as other cryptocurrency news. And Cool Story Podcast. And here is the promo for Cool Story Podcast. Thank you for listening to my show. You can find me, Herojob Scheib, on the Twitter at Musings of a Scheib. You can find me at Google Plus as Musings of a Scheib. You can also find me on Facebook as Herojob Scheib or Musings of a Scheib. You can also click on the show notes and look into the links and click directly onto those links. You can find me on my webpage, which is Musings of a Scheib at WordPress.com, the subreddit Musings of a Scheib Podcast. You can also email me directly as Musings of a Scheib at Outlook. You can find the show and listen to the show on iTunes, Mixcloud, SoundCloud, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, CryptoBucket, and SFXIO. You can also find Nerdist Podcast, me at Nerdist Podcast Coalition Group, a great podcast coalition on the Facebook. Thank you and have a great day. To the moon.